Now, in James, it speaks, and James is a book that, apart from the Pauline epistles, using a few verses in James, one can prove the truth of Calvinism. It boils down to a few words. This is why you Bible ignoramuses, I use that word in kindness, not in anger, but those of you that thump that King James Bible, but teach that a born-again man can go to hell, or that there are variables in the warp and woof of time, and in the very fabric of existence, that divine providence has not worked out all things prior to the foundation of the world, I must call you a liar against the truth. Because if we see this in James 1:18, of his own will begat he us with the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures, of his own will, not of the will of man, nor the will of flesh, nor the blood of men, but it's of God that men are born again. They are quickened, and then they see their sinful estate, they see the sinless Savior, and they cast all their cares upon him. They see all their sin on Jesus laid. To quote Wesley's hymn, of his own will begat he us with the word of truth. Men are born again through the word of truth. Therefore, they cannot be born again apart from the word of truth. If James be true, and James is true because it's not his word, it's God's word, you must have the word of truth. This comes down to the issue of the translation. And the issue of the translation is this. If this translation, this King James Bible, can make you wise unto salvation, if loyalty, fidelity, and all your being can be hung upon the words that are in this book, and that rightly so, and with full assurance that these words will uphold you in time of trouble, just as Christ upholds you in time of trouble, that these words are quick and powerful, that they are indeed alive as Jesus Christ is alive. See, I'm bearing witness to the fact that he is the first begotten from amongst the dead, that he is a true and faithful witness. I am not always a true and faithful witness. While I will not deny the truth insofar it concerns the gospel and this Bible, my behavior, your behavior, my thoughts, your thoughts are not always God's thoughts. And some of you Arminian dogs, you believe in some state of sinless perfection for men and vessels of earth and vessels of clay. This is not taught in the scripture. It's wicked. It's unclean. It's a dirty doctrine. It's come up from the earth and not come down from heaven. It's God's will that begets us with the word of truth. So the means whereby men are begotten again onto a lively hope is the means that Peter speaks of in 1 Peter 1:21, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. The word of God has always been and will always be. It's passed down through time and language, and I have it before me right now. And I believe, as John Bunyan believed, that it's infallible. That's what he called the English translation. He called it infallible when he was being judged. Don't believe anything different than what he believed. You see a great conformity amongst those that truly believe the English translation across a great period of time. And nothing has superseded this English translation, and it's hard to think that anything ever would. I know there are many King James proponents that teach things different from what the Reformers taught, from what the English Protestants and Puritans taught in the 1600s, 1700s, 1800s, or even what I teach. These people teach different things now from what was taught then, and they go at variance and teach this rabid dispensationalism and various other things. But when they teach that there is an unlimited atonement available to sinners, and if sinners grasp hold of this unlimited atonement through an act of their will, then they can be saved. They lie against the truth. If it's an act of your will that saved you, then you're not born again by the word of truth of God's will. Oh, but it's God's will that all men be saved. It's not in the scripture. I've already showed you that. Washed us from our sins in his own blood. Pardon me for the mispronunciation of the simple word. Washed us from our own sins, from our sins in his own blood. I've been washed from my sins in the blood of Christ. Have you been washed from your sins in the blood of Christ by a work of God and not your own work? Now, over in John chapter 18, and I want to go down to about verse, let's see. I want to go to verse 33. Then Pilate entered into the judgment hall again and called Jesus and said unto him, Art thou the King of the Jews? Jesus answered him, Sayest thou this thing of thyself, or did others tell it thee of me? Pilate answered, Am I a Jew? Thine own nation and the chief priest have delivered thee unto me. What hast thou done? Jesus answered, My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then would my servants fight, that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now is my kingdom not from hence. The very plain words of the Lord Jesus in John 18:36 are this. His kingdom is not of this world. Of means to proceed forth from. It doesn't come out of this world. We don't need any Greek or Hebrew text or anything like that to understand this message. His kingdom is not something that's of this world. His kingdom is not from hence. It's not from here. That's what he said. Now is my kingdom not from hence. It's a spiritual kingdom, which at the last will be manifested in a literal visible kingdom at the restoration of the Jews. But the 70th week of Daniel has already been fulfilled. That's a teaching of the historic Baptist, the particular Baptist, such as John Gill. That was the belief of Martin Luther. That was the belief of the English Puritans. It's been the belief of the majority of Calvinists, including John Calvin. At one place or another, you'll find him admitting some sort of restoration of the physical people of God at the last, who are not now his people. He secures them, and he keeps them, and he keeps their lineage alive upon the earth. But his people now are whosoever believeth in him, and those that have believed on him and have gone on to be called the church triumphant in heaven. There's one fold, there's one shepherd. But his people, which he died for, his people from whom he has a witness and a testimony, he shall save his people from their sins. His kingdom doesn't proceed forth from flesh and blood. It doesn't proceed forth from the works of man. It doesn't come from what's done on the earth. It comes from what God did eternally and decreed to do eternally and then effectuated in the earth under the Son. And now the Son of God, the Lord Jesus Christ, has gone back to heaven. The heaven has received him to the restitution of all things till that time. Pilate therefore said unto him, Art thou a king then? Jesus answered, Thou sayest that I am a king. And this is the crux of the matter. This is the crossroad of the sermon. To this end was I born, and for this cause came I into the world, that I should bear witness unto the truth. Everyone that is of the truth heareth my voice. Pilate says unto him, What is truth? And when he had said this, he went out again unto the Jews, and saith unto them, I find in him no fault at all. I find in him no fault at all either. I never have, and I don't see how I ever could. I find no fault in his word. But I would tell you that when you find fault in the word of God, you find fault with Jesus Christ. When you believe that God is not able to keep his word and bring it forward to people in the international language of the end times, in the business language of the end times, and keep it pure, holy, harmless, and undefiled, even though it was translated by sinners into its current and final form, it's an attack upon my Savior. To say that you believe the Word of God and then decline from it is an attack upon my Savior. To say that He has spoken and He's not able to make it good is an attack upon the Lord Jesus Christ. And as it was at the time that He was upon the earth, so it is now.